Let's start the session then by giving a brief background and objectives and rationale for this session. We know that the demand of water is on the rise. Population growth, urbanization, development in general, food production, anything that is implied with development and growth required water. But we are in a region where water is very scarce and the supply is on decline. Essentially, the climate change is doing also his part in reducing the availability. The groundwater has been largely depleted so far, so essentially we have a problem of escalation of this water scarcity. The divide between supply and demand is increasing, fastly increasing. At the same time, we know that we have set the Sustainable Development Goals 2030, which is tomorrow, essentially, to ensure availability and sustainability, sustainable management of water and sanitation for all. So it's quite aspirational, quite ambitious, and we have several targets, from access to safe and affordable drinking water, to access to sanitation, increasing the efficiency and the sustainability of water resources availability, the reduction of pollution, the adoption of integrated water resource management, and the protection of ecosystems. So we are very ambitious, very aspirational. The reality might be different. And this session would like to tackle this point. Are we in a situation in which the different sector, we will see the challenges of the industries, how to treat wastewater in order to recover precious resources, how to protect the environment, what are the health implications when we don't have certain boundary condition in order? So what we will have is a series of presentation, three major presentations from three eminent speakers. I will introduce now one by one. Then we will have a question and answer from the audience with afterward a little presentation of a movie related not only to the global process of a sustainable development goal, of what are the major technology. No, a movie that takes in evidence the people, a person, in a special condition, difficult, not privileged, and what is their perception when they talk about the water. It will be a brief, but will be a nice and interesting little let's say, passage between two sessions. Shortly after the movie, we will have the panel discussion. And in the panel discussion, we'll take in consideration also this aspect of sustainability, how to address those problem of sustainable water resource management, achieving the SDG in a situation of high scarcity. And we have eminent representative that I will introduce one by one as we arrive to that point. So I will then, without further ado, ask to start with the first presentation. And the first presentation will be from Professor Sven Geisen, if I pronounce correctly. And he has 30 years of research and practical experience in wastewater and sludge treatment. He has published more than 65 papers in referee journal. He is co-inventor of 6 patents, an elected chair of a GVC Decema expert group. We'll tell what this is. Sorry for my ignorance. On production integrated water and wastewater technology. But he's also president of AquaNet Network, and member of the executive board of German Water Partnership. But he is working in this region. He started his activity in the MENA region more than 20 years ago, when he initiated and coordinated a project in the European Union Avicen Initiative. Meanwhile, he has successfully completed or applied for many projects with colleagues from Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Lebanon, Syria, and Jordan. His research interests are industrial water treatment, management, and reuse. And he will present, in fact, the challenges in industrial water management. Professor Gessen?
I start. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for the introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, it's working. Thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am very honored to give you a presentation and to take you with me a short trip into industrial wastewater management. And my intention is to show you, to identify and to show you, to introduce you into possibilities and opportunities in industrial wastewater management to reduce water consumption, water use, and water pollution. So my talk is structured into introduction, water demand. I will give you some examples with respect to implementation and briefly introduce you to the topic zero liquid discharge, which might be an option. And I will summarize my talk at the very end. So, before I do so, it was mentioned by the chairman that a member of the board of German Water Partnership. German Water Partnership is an association of 350 members in German, of German companies, basically small and medium-sized enterprises, and component manufacturers, engineering companies, and research institutions are the main memberships who are members of German Water Partnership. Inshallah, we will organize next February a German Water Partnership Day here in Cairo, and you're very welcome to join our GWP Day. So the question for industry, as industry is using, so we have to be careful with the word consumption, because consumption, usually we do not consume water. We are utilizing water. That means after the use, in the particular in industrial use, but also for your personal use, the water is still present. It's polluted, but the water is still present. And the same with industry. About 10% of the water, industrial water, which is used, is evaporated or going transferred into product. 90% is usually released into the environment, containing all of the things which we are producing, intermediate products, waste products, etc., but also valuables. That's very important. Second point, industrial production without water is not possible. There is no chance. Water is and will be the most important solvent for industry. So no water, no production. That's obvious. And therefore, the motivation for investment is water demand. If you have no water, there is no production. So therefore, it's the highest motivation to invest into water recycling technologies, to invest into better housekeeping, etc., overcome water scarcity in industrial production. When you're looking at the numbers in Egypt, about 8%, 9% of the total water demand is related to industry. It's a small portion, but the pollution potential is much higher than these 5 to 10%. And that's something which we have to take into account also when we're talking about water scarcity. It's not only the question of quantity, it's also the question of quality. And I briefly address some aspects like pharmaceuticals in water, microplastic, etc., which we have to address in order to have safe water supply for the humans, but also for agriculture. So the priorities today are related to laws, economics, energy efficiency partly. This is the situation today. Tomorrow, in the future, we will address different priorities. which are recovery of valuables. As I mentioned before, the wastewater, the industrial wastewater, contains valuables. These are products which have been purchased by the companies, which have been produced by the companies, therefore they are valuables. The challenge is that the concentrations are too low. Yeah, and it's a mixture of, let's say, 1,000 substances, finally. Another very important trend is sustainability and green labeling. If you visit the websites of large companies, international companies, like Dow, like BASF, like Volkswagen, like any other company, you will find information about sustainability. So this is a strong trend initiated by us, by the consumers. We are forcing the companies to invest into green products, to produce green, yeah? Green economy. That's something which we are forcing, and this trend already started. So therefore, I'm involved in project where money is not the first aim. The first aim is green labeling. And last but not least, independency, because if you're investing hundreds of millions of US dollar or euros into a site for industrial production, you would like to produce for minimum 10 years, 20 years. And we have seen worldwide situations where from one day to another day, the legal situation completely changed in India, in China. And therefore, another motivation is to be independent on legislative decisions. So these are the motivations. The question is water demand. I mentioned before that water is essential. It's the most important solvent in industrial processes. So looking a little bit into the history of Germany, learning lessons. In a publication I just summarized here in this next transparency, the water demand in industry is predicted to increase until the year 2030 by about 24 to 30%. Why? Because production, higher quality products, that was the arguments of the colleagues who published these articles, higher quality products demand for more water. German experience is different, and I show you only one example. I have several examples, not only from pulp and paper factory like shown here, also from steel industry, from chemical industry. That's something what we have learned. We can reduce the water demand, and here it's shown clearly that we can reduce, starting from the year 1974 to the year 2001, we have been able to reduce the water demand by 80%, or in this case, the wastewater production in liter per kilogram of pulp and paper produced. So we are able to reduce the water demand by 80%. The question is why? So if I'm asking you the question why the water demand has been reduced, you would think about technologies. There are like membrane filtration and other technologies which have been applied. But keep in mind, these years we haven't had membranes available during that period. No membranes at all. So the explanation is quite simple. Better housekeeping, training, education of people, better production machines, no wastewater recycling. During these years, no recycling processes have been introduced. Additionally, but the water demand was reduced by 80%. That's a very essential result, experience we made in Germany, which you can take and which you can introduce into your countries. Implementation, water management is quite complex, and I will not go into detail, just showing you a result from a European funded project. It was a 15 million euro project in European process industry, where in this case it's a PVC production located in Spain. And they faced, in nearby Barcelona, they faced a challenge that during July, in the summer months, they haven't sufficient water. And that's another lesson we have learned. Don't look only for the water supply and the wastewater discharge price. Look for production losses. Production losses means that this company was not able to produce for a couple of weeks. And if you calculate these production losses, you will figure out a lot of money which was lost. And if you're making these calculations, finally you can invest into water management, in water technology, without looking basically only for the price per cubic meter. Production losses. If you're not able to produce, you will lose a lot of money. And that's another force, another possibility to improve water management. This is a model which we developed during this period of PVC production in nearby Barcelona. And this shows you the complexity of water management in industrial facilities. So here we developed a model for water flows, substance flow, and heat flow. That's another point we have to address. The large blue lines which you see, now that's not working, the large blue lines which you see here, over here, this is indicating the amount of water which is used. So it's the thickness of the lines is indicating the amount of water. And on the top you see the large blue lines is cooling water. So we have to address also this aspect. So we have a project in Iran, in Isfahan, in two steel companies, 6 million tons, in total 10 million tons about steel production per year. They're facing the same problem, water demand, lack of water. And this is basically related to lack of cooling water. And you can identify here in this scheme that it's true also for this PVC production. So we have to address also the aspect of cooling water in water management. These are some examples. I will not go into deep explanation because I expect you are no experts in water or wastewater treatment. However, technologies are available. We are developing new technologies, more efficient technologies, more selective technologies, based on biological reactions. And this is an example in a water scarce area in the northeastern part of Australia, nearby Brisbane. It's a brewery, and I have chosen this example because it's food production. And you can imagine that recycling of water in food production is highly challenging. But they installed recycling schemes, and they have been able to save about 50% of the water. How? Very simply, by this process scheme. Again, no details, just showing you the scheme, which is quite complex. So you need different treatment steps. Biological treatment steps, membrane filtration treatment steps, et cetera, in order to be able to have safe water, to produce safe water for recycling applications. What are the challenges? Not the membranes, for example. The challenges are energy, which is required to recycle water, and finally the concentrates. We are producing, while applying membrane filtration, we are producing concentrates. And the question is what to do with the concentrates at the end of the day. And my personal observation is these concentrates are the mirror of water technology, because we are rejecting all substances, organics, inorganics, everything. Everything is finally ending up in the concentrates at high concentration level, but as a mixture. And to see, again, a little bit complex for those of you who are not in the topic. However, this is a closed process scheme, a typical process scheme for a water recycling process. A biological step for removal of the organics, partly removal, but we have substances which cannot be removed biologically, which are ending up in the concentrates. You can see that finally we're producing 900 cubic meter per day of clear, high purified water, but also 200 cubic meter per day of highly concentrated concentrates. And the question is what to do with the concentrates. Different treatment steps can follow up, usually are following up until evaporation. So and finally, at the end of the day, we have about 1.2 kilograms, 1.2 tons of salts and organics, a mixture which is lying in front of you, dry solids. And the question is what to do with the dry solids at the end of the day. So we have purified water, but at the other hand, we have salts, organic solids, which we have to get rid of. That's the challenge we are facing right now in industry, in industrial applications, but also in desalination. So everywhere we are applying membranes, we are facing the challenge of concentrates. Zero liquid discharge means that production facilities are not discharging liquids anymore. And we made an investigation all around the world, and in order to figure out, is this really a trend, or it's just individually, regional, limited application of zero liquid discharge. We made a review, and finally, we received 156 feedbacks all around the world, which ended up in the question for the motivations. So 40% of the companies who are applying zero liquid discharge are doing this because of water scarcity. Yeah? Remember my statement at the very beginning, water, if no water is available, no production is possible. So water scarcity is one of the motivations. The second one, legislative restrictions. So in China, I just came from China. In China, we have, since this year, we have such strict regulations for industrial discharge, more stricter than in the European Union, much more stricter. And therefore, many companies are forced to go this way into zero liquid discharge, so legislative restrictions. Then 12% corporate philosophy, that means green labeling, also mentioned before. And a smaller part, cost reduction and no infrastructure. So basically, water demand is the highest driving force. The trend is clear. More and more ZLD plants, zero liquid discharge plants, are installed worldwide. So it's something which is under development and leading to possibilities, opportunities at the one hand side to recycle water, but we have to be very careful due to the costs, due to the energy demand, due to the solids at the end of the day which we are producing. So basically, I'm just like to briefly summarize my presentation. Reduction of water demand is possible. Good housekeeping, education and training. Go to the companies, go through the companies, give them some advices, and additionally improve production processes. This has a disadvantage that you have to make investment. I know that's difficult, but good housekeeping education is basically something which you can get for low money. Treatment and recycling is possible. We have innovative processes which are able to recover even valuables which are present in the wastewater and which can generate some added value. And finally, management, which is ending up in digitalization. You know, in Germany we call it Industry 4.0. That means Internet of Things, which will be applied also in water technology, in water treatment, water supply, and smart grids, but additionally modeling and simulation. Thank you very much for the attention. And I just like to draw your attention to three events which will take place in the near future related to these topics I already mentioned. This desalination in Tunisia, end of this month. Then we have industrial water, end of November, an IWA conference, and additionally the Reuse conference, which will take place in Berlin, in my hometown, which we are organizing. This is the 12th IWA International Conference on Water Reclamation and Reuse, and you're very much invited to join these conferences. And additionally, some information about position papers on the topic I introduced to you, industrial water management, which we released during the last 4 years, which are also available in English, free download as PDF documents. You will find, under this address, you will find access to these documents, Trends and Perspectives Industrial Water Technology 2030. That's an outlook to 2030. What will be the future in industrial water management, and additionally, what is zero liquid discharge, what are the challenges related to zero liquid discharge. Thank you very much.